nigga bigger than gorilla, cause I'm killing every nigga that can try to be on my shit. Better cuff your chick if you with it, I can get it, and she accidentally slip and fall on my dick. Oops, I said on my dick. I ain't really mean to say on my dick, but since we talking about my dick, all of you here to say.
Crips wear blue, Reds wear red, Rod wear black. Explain, cause wear pink.
Let's go!
Cause I'm feeling like I'm running and I'm
for every woman that ever had her hands laid on by me. For my mother, my sister, Tina Turner, got her!
And I know that I gotta be a little cocky. You ain't never gonna stop me. Every time I come, a nigga gotta set it, then I gotta go, and then I gotta get it, then I gotta blow it, and I gotta shut it. Any little thing a nigga think that he be doing, cause it doesn't matter, cause I'm gonna dead it, then I'm gonna murder everything.
Well, hey, you guys, welcome back to Intimate Talk with Mama Boo. I'm here with a famous celebrity, a funny celebrity, comedian Scruncho. What's going on? So, take us from childhood. Where were you born and what schools did you go to?
Long Beach, California. I was born in Chicago, then we moved out here when I was four. I think my dad was running from a gas station robbery or something. Then we got off the train, they scooped him up, went to jail, then we were stuck out here. Then we went to move to Nickerson Gardens.
Really?
Yeah, okay. Staying in Nickerson's. And I went to 112th Street School. I stayed there on 115th. And then I left there when I was eight. Then moved to Long Beach.
Okay.
And I've been there ever since.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what high school did you graduate from?
Well, so I post had a graduate
from.
Yeah, I was supposed to graduate from Long Beach Jordan, but I ended up going to jail. But it was kind of cool because I got caught up with my credits real fast.
Okay.
So I graduated ahead of my class. You know what I mean? So
okay.
I need to gain credits to go to jail. Jail can be a blessing.
Oh Lord! Don't tell them that, because I'm going to jail, so I'm going to graduate.
Yeah, man, get your grades up.
So when did you know you was funny? Because I know you was like a funny kid.
Man, you know what? I always tell people the greatest gift my mom and dad gave me was neglect. You know what I'm saying?
Cause okay.
It enhanced my ability to be funny. But I kind of knew I was funny, like, you know, back in the day, my mom and dad, you know, like, one thing they taught me is I would never love nobody that's ignorant, because I'm ignorant.
Okay.
But I'm a recovering ignorant holic.
Like, who says that? But,
so what that mean is, you know, 15 years ago, if I'm in the club getting it and I see some niggas walk in, they look like they finna set it off. You know what I mean? I'm gonna go to the car, get my strap, and approach the situation.
Okay.
But now I'm being an ignorant, recovering ignorant holic. If some niggas walk in now, I'm like, boo, we gotta get up out of here.
Okay.
I'm gonna avoid it.
Okay.
But if I love somebody that's ignorant, it's no avoidment.
Right.
And my mom and dad had an ignorant relationship, you know.
Okay.
And that's how I learned how to decorate, because, you know, they used to tear up the furniture every 3 to 6 months.
Damn.
You know what I mean? So, and then they beat each other up and tear up the furniture, and then they sitting on the couch. Couch broke, TV kicked in, and they sitting there all beat up looking at each other the next day, looking stupid. You know what I'm saying? So I ain't messing with nobody ignorant.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Okay.
And then I kind of knew I was funny, because they argue. They argue, you know, this new world is super sensitive. Extremely sensitive. Uh-huh. And the way they was arguing, it was hardcore arguing.
Like some real,
like,
real hurt your
you
feelings.
You big, fat, funky, nasty bitch. And he's like, who you told? Who was you? Who you calling funky? You weasel dick? Dusty?
Right.
And they call each other.
Assassinating characters.
Yeah, they kill each other then. I was like a mama's boy. So after the fight, after she, dad leave, you know, the reality kick in, she be sitting there broken. So she cry. So one day she like, what the fuck, why you crying? I was like, cause you ain't no big, fat, ugly, thank you, bitch.
Oh my God. OMG, like that.
Yeah, so.
So you was the kid out of the family that had everybody laughing.
Yeah, I was just unfiltered.
And you didn't get in trouble for being unfiltered?
I got in trouble for everything. So after a while, it was numbing to me. you know, slaps across the head, get pushed down, stupid motherfucker. That was just the way it was. Sit your ignorant ass down. Get your ass. Just say excuse me. You know what I mean? Like, we, you know, black people back then, we didn't get disciplined for what we did. We got the discipline for the frustration behind what we did. Mm-hmm. So our parents had quick temper. So every time we out of pocket or disrespectful, they snap, what the right fuck you say to me? Then they come in the house with, you know.
Or you look like you may have been thinking something.
Yeah, what are you doing? You know what I mean? And one time I went for eat, you know, back in the day, they're about territorial food and shit. So, you know. It was a big issue, like, oh, you drunk mama soda?
Right.
I don't drink mama soda. Big old issue on the soda. So, the big old, so dad coming up, who the fuck drunk the goddamn? And I knew it wasn't me. Somebody drunk it was you. All right, that's what. And he whooped me, then he beat me for the soda. And then find out I didn't drink the soda. And then say some shit like, well, that's for what you should have. I need you. That's for what you got away with. And you can't say I'm sorry.
Right, no.
You know what I mean?
No.
So, yeah, so I come from that type of shit, you know. So,
how many siblings do you have?
I got 4 sisters and 2 brothers.
And where do you fall in?
Right smack in the middle. I was the baby of the boys and the youngest. And I had 2 sisters younger than me, so I was right in the middle.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. So do you think that you had the middle kid syndrome? Like, you didn't get the new stuff because you wasn't the oldest one, but yet you didn't get baby because you wasn't the baby.
Yeah, I had worse than the middle. Well, I was the black child. You know, I come from an era where, you know, racism for us started our own immediate family.
Yes.
My dad light skinned, his sisters and them light skinned. I'm the only dark ugly nigga. Mm-hmm. And so back then, if you were dark, black and ugly just went together. Like, I never, mm-hmm. you know, back when I was little, you know, black and ugly, I didn't even know, I thought my name was black and ugly. I couldn't get a compliment without black and ugly being. I mean, first time my auntie seen me in my Easter suit on, I thought, oh, look at your little black self. You look too cute. I was like, thank you.
Damn.
But damn. You know, it's just the way it was. It wasn't even personal, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You just got so used to being, if that's what it was, you just adapt to it.
Absolutely.
You know, I didn't know how to run, to cry. I didn't even know it was wrong until I got grown, you know.
Right,
I mean?
that's a lot that a lot of us struggle with thinking that that's the norm, where it is the norm, and thinking that it's okay when in reality you're being suppressed, you're being abused on a lot of levels. And like how you're saying, with people like, you know, black and ugly or whatever, to me, my mom and all of them used to always be like, shut up.
Yeah.
I was a kid that always had something to say,
yeah.
But I was a little star, you know what I mean? But it was always, shut up, you're talking too much, shut up, you're talking,
supposed
to allow me express myself.
And shut up was nice, but they used to tell me, shut your goddamn.
Right, like, and I was like, well, let me just shut up, but you may have something good to say.
Yeah,
you know,
they
it was
suppress
just,
you.
Yeah, very much so.
Yeah.
Very much so. So have you ever gang banged?
You know, it's crazy how I tell people, like, only reason they even consider me gang bang is because I'm from Long Beach.
Okay.
So there's no blood neighborhoods in Long Beach. The whole city is Crips.
Okay.
So I'm a street nigga, I'm a hustler, so they already put that Crip jacket on me. You know what I mean? Because you got Crippish type ways.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm more of a, you know, it's a difference between a gangster and a gangbanger. You know what I mean?
Yes,
a gangbanger got, they kill for the color, they set their hoods. Gangsters just go by the rules of like gangbangers. So we ain't gonna snitch, we're gonna be solid, and we gotta be hustlers. So you gotta have a little gangster in you if a nigga don't push that line.
Mm-hmm.
So you gotta stay fade ready, and we go by the same set of rules. I just don't see the irony of, damn, wait a minute, so I'm letting a Chinese in the hood. He running off with $50,000 his liquor store every month.
Mm-hmm.
You know, SA's in the hood, they running off with the oranges and the and all that little shit. So the church is making all the money. So I'm bypassing all the white boys and the police who killing all of us. I'm bypassing them, but I'm running to a nigga that look like me, act like me, dress like me, and kill him because his flag is different.
Yeah,
I could never gather that. So me, my mentality was, you know, I catch a fade with you, but I'm not just gonna be killing niggas, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, but I understood him, it was what you was.
You was a fighter?
Yeah, I'm still good for the shoulders. I stay fade ready. You know what I mean?
I believe you.
Yeah, I'm gonna stay fade ready. You know what I mean? But one thing, Rock and, you know, Rock my cousin, but the one thing he always taught me is don't be a shit starter.
Right.
So I ain't never started shit, because shit starters don't last.
True.
You know what I mean? So I leave people alone. I don't fuck with nobody. I stay in my lane. I don't speak on what ain't. My name ain't in it. I don't speak on it. You know what I mean? If I got something to say, I'm approach the situation and the nigga I'm going to say it to.
That part.
Other than that, I'm going to try to, you know, I'm going to try to stay like Casper in this motherfucker.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Get it how you live.
Less is best. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Exactly.
So when did comedy come into it? How did you transition from, or did you transition from being a hustler to comedy? Or was it you merging the both?
Man, when I used to go to jail, right, you know, especially selling dope, you always trying to get a sack, you coming up, taking losses, you coming up, and it was a balance, like trying to find a spot. And then I remember every time we go to the county jail, they go for warrants and stuff like that, and get out there, be back on your come up. So most niggas will go to Hollywood and jack niggas for Rolexes and stuff like that. You know, easy 10 bands. Mm-hmm. So I was going to get a Rolex, and I remember snatching off this corny ass white boy. I was like, shut your mouth, then don't say nothing. And he was saying that as soon as I got on, and I was right there on Sunset, he like, I'm in a row, I'm like this hoe. So I was there, yeah, right there, I'm trying to get my run on. And so I remember I ran into a comedy club, and I was trying to run through the comedy club to hit the heels, you know what I mean? But they had cars. Hey, who next on the mic is? I just grabbed
Don't
the mic.
Don't tell me you did that.
Yeah. Matter of fact, I had that's in my bio when I did it.
Mm-hmm.
And Robert Townsend, my nigga, but I think they took that story from me out of the and put it in a movie. Cause somebody told me that was in this movie. But I remember snatching the mic, going on stage and telling them, yo, I just did some stuff. Police after me. If the police walk in, y'all act like I'm a comedian.
And everybody laughing.
And now everybody looking at me like, what the fuck is he talking about?
Yeah.
Then the police came in and looking around, everybody looked. And that was my first stand ovation.
Are you serious?
Yeah, first stand ovation. Yeah. And woo, woo. And police laugh, and then I said, I'm good looking out. And they're like, what was that stand ovation? I ran through the back and got the fuck up out of there.
So how did that make you go back?
That did make me go back. That had nothing to do with me being a comedian. I was just, that's just the first time I was being on stage. But it's kind of ironic, but I was pretending to be a comedian. You know, I was really in acting like I was hitting licks, but the reality was I was really a comedian pretending to be a robber.
Mm.
See, I got to turn everything
around. Yeah, exactly. See?
And exactly. Then, maybe a couple of years later after that, homie, like
years later,
because that happened like by 95. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Then like maybe 96, 97, I was in the hood bag, and the one of the homies like, man, you think you funny, nigga, on stage and do this? I said, I don't give a fuck. He like, let's go. I said, I'm taking you Sunday. Then I go Sunday to go on stage. He said, you just gotta sign the list, then we're gonna go up on stage and da da da. I said, okay, cool, there ain't nothing. So I get there Sunday about 2:00, and the rule is you sign the list at 3:00,
okay.
And then you come back at 7:00 and you perform. And you,
okay.
Every comedian do 3 minutes. So I got there.
That's short. Okay.
3 minutes is a long time.
If you're up there on stage.
If you ain't got nothing to say.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Okay.
You know, and it's a saying in comedy. If you ain't funny in 3 minutes, guess what? You ain't gonna be funny in 10.
Yeah.
So 3 minutes is a long time to try to make somebody laugh. You know what I mean?
Okay. Because you gotta hit it out the chute.
Like everybody think they funny until you put a mic in their hand. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
That motherfucker get real heavy. And you learn real quick that it's an art. You know what I mean? This shit ain't nothing to play with. You know? So I go there to sign the list, and this crowd is like about 200 people. I'm thinking like, dang, all these people come for the comedy show. This shit gonna be cracking. And that was my first time seeing that all the people that was signing the list was comedians.
Mm.
And that's the first time I felt like intimidated. Like, all these niggas think they're funny.
Mm-hmm. It was just so everybody judging everybody, yeah, opposed like, to just
yeah,
relaxing.
And we all amateurs.
Right.
And I go to sign the list, and I'm seeing all these people with everybody trying to be funny. And we all amateurs, so we all got like a false sense of, you know, security.
Mm-hmm.
We all really think we're funny, but not really knowing it. You know, and so that was my first time.
Just, how did you do?
I done terrible. I mean, I remember I had everybody come to the show, my moms, and I think I flew my grandmama in or some shit.
Really?
My grandmama had flew in, so I told her to come. She came. Then they all, I'm sitting, I go to the stage, I'm like walking the death row.
Damn.
I was scared. I ain't never felt fear. I've been shot. At that point, I was shot. I've been stabbed. I've been robbed. I've been in prison. So I'm like, what make me have fear? I didn't give a fuck. But when they called my name to be funny, shit, that was a different kind of fear. You know what I mean?
Really?
When I hopped on stage, I looked in the front row, and my heart was sitting in the front, talking about, I ain't got nothing to do with this shit.
You're your own.
Nigga, that's all I'm saying. I ain't fucking with this shit. Like, nigga, I mean, you, nigga, I ain't got nothing to do with it.
OMG.
And my grandmama, she was in the audience talking about, you brought me all the way out for this shit? Say something.
Are you serious?
Say something. I
was like, are you serious?
In my spirit.
You know how no support, they want support?
Yeah, in my spirit, I'm like, bitch. Talking to, you know what I'm saying? So, and she had been funnier than me. I said, man, I look, that was the worst day of my life.
Damn. How long did it take for you to get funny? Like, what did you have to do?
Man, I was revengeful. So I said, man, I was so hurt and so embarrassed.
Right? Was hurt.
Because, you know, our family, that got, you know, this new generation family would have been like, you know, hang in there, brother.
Yeah, which is YouTube something.
It's just
know.
Okay. You know, it's okay. You gonna get him. Back then, my brother was like, I told your ass you ain't funny, nigga. You got your ass, God's coming all the way out here, nigga. You ain't got no good. I told you the nigga ain't funny. And then my son's like, you was not funny. Hey, you, we all be laughing. You was not funny. My grandma was talking about, I could have just stayed home and watched The Price is Right and come and watch you do all that bullshit. Just, we didn't come up here just to watch you hold the mic. Why you didn't say nothing?
You didn't say nothing?
I was just starting that shit out. I understand what you're saying. I was sleepy. You got me coming all out here.
Dang.
My brother's talking about, oh, nigga ain't riding back with me. Fuck them. Yeah, you ain't riding back with me. I'm like, man, let me get
damn
out of here.
Damn.
Yeah.
They did you in.
Man, they was hurt too. So, you know, black people hurt. We lash out. Oh, bitch ass. No, we don't know what I'm saying.
You got me out
really
here this shit, nigga.
Yeah, they had high hopes on me. You know what I'm saying? My grandma was talking about, you got me wearing this night dress. I could have just wear this to Sunday school. I could have went and played bingo. And you got me wearing my dress to sit there and watch you don't do nothing. Oh, man.
Oh, my God. So when did you become funny? Like, what was the process? You say you was vengeful. So you was like, I got to get it. I got to work it out.
You know, it's sad.
How long did it take?
It's crazy. I'm going to be honest with you, right? I seen the calendar, and it just had me crying. You know, because I could say, like, last 15 years, you know, I just been going up dead last. And I'm just used to killing it. You know what I'm saying? Like a machine now. Like, I just,
got
you know,
there.
It's deep. But, you know, I found the calendar when I first started, like, 97.
Okay.
And I was, like, making little footnotes, you know what I mean? I was looking at the calendar, and it just kind of made me cry because I was bombing. Like, out of 30 days, I bombed, like, 26 days of the fucking no mutt, you know what I mean?
Really?
I was bombing every night. But in my narcissist today, I would have never remembered that if I didn't see that calendar. Mm. So that calendar always keep me humble.
Humble.
Yeah, and I was bombing. And then probably, if you look at the first month, start the calendar, I was bombing like, you know, probably 27 or maybe 1 or 2 days. Like, I did good. You know what I mean?
Oh, wow. The crowd and then, was that
And
harsh?
It was like, oh, man, bomb, did bad. Oh, heckler. Oh, nobody laugh. Oh, people booed me. Oh, booed. Oh, man, I should have hit harder. Oh, I had a first at the good. At the end, it was terrible. Oh, man, 5 minutes was hell. You know, it was just like, I was like, oh, man, you know?
Damn. So, yeah, that was, would be humbling.
Yeah, that was super humbling. So that's like, I'm like, now I just don't never, every time I hit the stage, I always, you know, remind myself where I come from.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't never cheat the stage. I always just commit to it all the time. Yeah, actually,
talking about the Bloods and the Crips. That's
yeah, that was,
more so what I remember.
That was Puff Daddy's Bad Boys, a comedy, you know, Comic View and all that.
Mm-hmm.
And because I had just missed the Def Jam era.
Okay.
Right. I had.
Hey. Welcome back. Welcome back. Welcome back. Thank you. Thank you. Please share and subscribe.
And as well, leave your comments below. Let me know what you're thinking. I really appreciate the love and the support. So until next time, in the meantime or between time, I'm going to be playing out who am I going to have next on Intimate Talk with Mama Boo. Thank you guys. Much love and respect.